Good afternoon to all, and I would like to thank APASL for giving me an opportunity to talk about use of indices to predict fluid responsiveness and unresponsiveness in cirrhotics with septic shock. So I'll take a case scenario and talk about concept of fluid resuscitation in patients with cirrhosis and try to answer difficult questions that we face in day-to-day practice. So this was a gentleman, 55 years old, who had a coronary artery disease, a triple vessel disease, and had CABG in 2009. He had a baseline ejection fraction of 45% and also was diagnosed as cirrhosis, possibly NASH related, had already decompensated and had ascites grade 2, which was controlled on diuretics, had come to us with a 3 weeks history of fever and burning micturition, diagnosed UTI outside, and was getting a course of oral antibiotics, and presented with reappearance of fever for 3 days, altered sensorium, and breathlessness for 1 day in the emergency department. So when we assessed this patient in the emergency, we found that this patient has a shock, a BP of 70 by 44. He had a heart rate of 118. He was febrile, had some Krebs, which were basal, and a respiratory rate, which was of 24. And he was drowsy and irritable with grade 3 to 4 encephalopathy and had mild free fluid, mild to moderate, which was controlled on diuretics. His pH was 7.32. He was requiring 6 liters of O2, on which the PO2 was 60, PCO2 of 27, bicarbonate of 19, and lactate of 6.9. He was given initial fluid resuscitation in the emergency by the fellow who gave him 500 ml of 5% albumin and 500 ml of crystalloid and started on broad spectrum antibiotics. However, after 2 hours of these resuscitation measures, he continued to have shock. The norepinephrine increased to 20 micrograms and vasopressin to 0.8, and urine output was rapidly, was just 20 ml after catheterization. And this patient was diagnosed to have septic shock, and he was electively intubated and shifted quickly to the liver intensive care unit. So what are the challenges faced when we see such complicated patients in the in our intensive care units? Does this patient need fluids considering the background cardiac problem and the respiratory problem in this patient? And renal dysfunction, obviously, which has already set in. How do we determine the amount of fluid, the type of fluid, and how do we monitor and decide de-escalation? So where do we need fluid resuscitation, or what is the concept? So basically, we need to understand that we need fluid in a hypertensive patient. You should always try and identify whether your patient needs fluids or not. And this is required because, like in our patient, we need to improve the renal perfusion. We need to improve the organ complications and see that these patients do not go into pulmonary edema. The patient should not go into problems associated with fluid, over aggressive fluid resuscitation. Therefore, there has to be a balance because both over and under resuscitation is associated with worse complications. So how do we assess a patient with hypertension or circulatory failure? So there are three basic components that we need to understand in these patients. The one is the preload concept, that is the hypovolemia. And here and where you require fluids or diuretics, and there are various ways to assess that. The patient may be hypovolemic, where you require diuretics. The pump function is important for us to assess because it could be cardiogenic shock, and these patients will require inotropes and other measures to support the pump. The afterload, and especially in patients with severe sepsis, you will have vasoplegia, a low SPR, and poor diastolic pressure, poor MAP, and there is where you require vasopressors. So what about cirrhotics with sepsis and hypertension? And do they differ? Yes, of course, they differ a lot. So most of these patients with cirrhosis will obviously have a CVP, or the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, which is usually a slightly on the higher side because of the ascites and the edema, peripheral edema. They are usually in the hyperdynamic circulatory state in the naive phase as well, because most of these patients have the hemodynamic alteration secondary to an advanced disease. And obviously they have poor SPR, diastolic dysfunction, a low mean arterial perfusion, which gets further exaggerated during sepsis. So because of the ascites and peripheral edema, these patients, even though they look hypervolemic, they are usually hypovolemic, and 40 to 50% of this extracellular volume is there in the interstitial compartment. These patients have low SPR, they're mostly tachycardic. However, there is also a challenge because these patients quickly go on to sodium retention with volume expansion. So we have to be very, very careful while giving these patients appropriate fluid strategy. So what targets are we looking at for patients with psoriasis? And this was suggested by this campaign or the consensus by the experts that you can look that you need to maintain a minimum arterial pressure of around 65. You need to have an organ perfusion, and you should see that the tissue perfusion is appropriate. We can see this and monitor this with the help of arterial lactate. We should see that we can target a good urine output and hemoglobin, which is above 7. Now, we all have heard about the demise of the early goal-directed therapy, but this early goal-directed therapy basically was suggested a protocol by Rivers et al., which told the intensivist and was followed by the intensivist across globally to target CVP, a mean arterial pressure, mixed venous oxygen, and see that your hemodynamic goals are maintained in the emergency department. However, there is a problem, and why this cannot be applicable to patients with liver disease, because most of these targets are usually not reliable in these patients. So we go on to the meta-analysis and why we are saying that there is a demise, because this was nicely alluded by 3 important trials performed in UK, US, and the Australia, the PROCESS, ARISE, and the PROMISE trials, and this was the meta-analysis wherein they actually tried to collate, and they further came out with the same conclusions that the goal-directed therapy is not useful for patients who presented with sepsis. What is important for us to consider here that liver disease was rather, patients with who had liver disease rather did worse with early goal-directed therapy. Now, this was a study from our group, and this emphasizes that we should be monitoring lactate in patients with liver disease who have sepsis, because lactate clearance is definitely associated with improved outcomes. And you can predict which patients are not doing well if your lactate clearances are not achieved in these patients. Now, we go on to the important question. So how do we identify in patients with hypertension who would benefit from fluid resuscitation? So these are the questions that we need to ask before we start planning a strategy for fluid resuscitation. How do we accurately assess the need? Does this patient have tissue edema? What is the patient's intravascular volume status at the point of assessment? Is the patient fluid responsive? And this is what is something which is very new and has come up, and the fluid resuscitation protocols have improved by using this concept of fluid responsiveness. And obviously you have to see that the pump function, the afterload indices, and all these important parameters have also been evaluated. So what we can do at the bedside is we can monitor the MAP, the pulse rate, we can look at the orthostatic changes, we can do a quick assessment of the mentation and a capillary refill time. You can look at the skin turgor and dryness, skin perfusion, and see for mottling or cold extremities. And importantly, you should see the base excess apart from lactate, pH, bicarbonate, and look at mixed venous or a central venous oxygenation, even though not very reliable, but definitely in hypovolemic and patients with cardiac problems, a venous oxygen may give us some clues to the problem. The monitoring tools have been abandoned, and we know that initially people were using static variables, that is the CVP, the pulmonary artery wedge pressures, and they were looking at the echocardiogram to look at the global end diastolic volume. However, with the advent of the dynamic variables, which I'll be discussing in most of my talk, the concepts of fluid resuscitation have improved. So why CVP has been abandoned? Because CVP does not correlate with the intravascular volume and the fluid responsiveness of the patient, and it has been abandoned in most ICUs. And similarly, with the wedge pressures and the pulmonary artery catheters, which were routinely placed in most of the ICUs, because of the poor sensitivity and specificity of picking up which patients would respond or not, these are not usually recommended apart from patients who have cardiac pump problem. So how do we define a fluid responder? What is a fluid responder? A patient in whom fluid administration would increase their cardiac output or stroke volume is a patient who is called as a fluid responder, and this can be assessed by giving a fluid challenge or doing a passive leg raising test, which I'll be discussing, and this will increase their cardiac output or stroke volume. So what is a fluid challenge? How much fluid do we need to give to assess the fluid responsiveness? So usually a 250 to 500 ml of a crystalloid or a 3 ml per kg of colloid is rapidly administered over a period of 5 to 10 minutes. So if the patient is lying on the flat portion of the curve, you will see that there will be an improvement in the stroke volume. And this is based on the Frank Starling law and the relationship of the cardiac muscles of how they respond to the increase in the volume. So this will translate into increased contractility and improvement in the stroke volume. If this is more than 10%, then your patient is a fluid responder. However, after a fluid challenge, if your patient does not have an increment in the stroke volume, this patient is a non-responder and you should not be giving these patients fluid. So the dynamic responsiveness can be assessed with the help of stroke volume variation, and we can also have a pulse contour analysis, which can tell us, these monitors can tell us about the pulse pressure variations, which are equally important and which can equally tell us with a good sensitivity of almost 89 to 90%. So how do we monitor? So if your patient is spontaneously breathing, we can do a very simple passive leg raising test. Now, passive leg raising test is a simple maneuver where you raise the limbs of the patient at around 45 degree, and so that you increase the venous flow from the venous compartment of the lower extremities to the heart. And this acts like a fluid challenge. So you're not giving any extra fluid from outside. It is a patient's own volume, and which is equivalent to around 150 to 300. It is very simple to do at bedside. Just takes 30 seconds and not more than 4 minutes. And it does not require any additional fluid to be given. So it is reversible. And clinical studies have shown that if a patient is fluid responsive in the passive leg raising test, which can be assessed by monitoring the cardiac echo, or a cardiac output monitoring device, where we can see that if there is an improvement in the cardiac output, this patient is a fluid responder, as against the patient where there is no improvement is a patient who is non-responder. We have EASY now, and we are using it quite commonly, the inferior vena cava collapsibility, because the vena cava collapsibility itself can be a very good assessment, and it is associated with good validation in different contexts, in different sets of patients who are spontaneously breathing. And you can see the variation in a spontaneously breathing patient with inspiration and expiration, the collapsibility index. And if your IVC is the diameter is small, and if the patient has a collapsibility of more than 25%, even with a large size IVC, there is where you can give the IV fluids. And in patients who are not fluid responsive, we should not be giving this. And this can be done simply and repeated at the bedside. So a very simple test. And this is just to show this patient with liver disease who had refractory ascites. After the ascitic tab, we gave some albumin. He was also in shock, had high lactate. And we can see that the IVC, the diameter was around 16 centimeters and it was collapsible. And this is the same patient. And we can see here that the IVC is almost full after giving volume, and therefore this patient was not given any further fluids. So this is how you can easily assess the CVP of these patients. If your IVC is less than 1.5 and it's totally collapsible, the CVP is around 0 to 5. However, if your IVC increases in size and there is loss of collapsibility, you are dealing with a high CVP, and in such patients you should be very, very cautious with the giving fluids. Now, coming to the mechanically ventilated patient, and we know that mechanically ventilated patients are more complex, but we need to understand what happens in these patients in the physiology. So when you give put your patient on the mechanical ventilation, there is a high positive pressure, which increases the pleural and the transpulmonary pressure. This subsequently results in a decrease in right ventricular preload, an increase in the right ventricular afterload, which results in a decrease in right ventricular stroke volume. On the same time, these patients will have an increase in left ventricular preload and decrease in left ventricular afterload and increase in left ventricular stroke volume during inspiration. And this is contributed as a maximum stroke volume or a maximum pulse pressure. The same patient during expiration will have an contrary, and there will be a decrease in the left ventricular stroke volume. So you will have a pulse pressure or a stroke volume variation, which is called as a dynamic index of managing fluids in these patients. So, but as we understand, there are so many factors involved. So this is much more complex in patients who have different other problems. So there's a lot which depends on the heart, the volume status, the compliance of the vascular system of these patients, and the circulatory time which it takes from right ventricle to the left ventricle. So all these factors will influence, and therefore something which looks very simple becomes very, very complicated in patients who have multiple issues. And there are several limitations also of these variations. These cannot be accurately assessed in heavily sedated patients. You require patients to be ventilated and heavily sedated, because conscious patients, again, will have spontaneous respiration and it's not reliable. The tidal volume of 8 ml per kg to ensure accurate, so it is not reliable in ARDS where we are giving low tidal volume, arrhythmias, and other problems such as raised intra-abdominal pressure and chest wall compliance will all influence your assessment of stroke volume variation. So this is the technique. How do we do this technique at the bedside? So we can do this with the help of the flow track system with the Edwards Biosciences, and this is a US-based device wherein a lot of indices are given to us by this machine, and this is the monitor. We can see here, we see on the monitor different indices, the stroke volume variation that we were talking about, the systemic vascular resistive index, the mixed venous oxygenation, the cardiac index, the patient's pulmonary vascular permeability index, extra lung water index. All these indices will be dealt with my colleague in detail, so I will not go into the depth. However, we can understand that when I showed you the physiology of a mechanically ventilated patient, whatever components are involved, so assessment of the cardiac pump function, assessment of the lungs, the permeability leak index in sepsis, ARDS, all these are answered by this machine, and you can have a dynamic assessment of these parameters, and you can accordingly maintain or do your strategies and change your strategies, because this is what is available at the bedside. So you have an assessment of all the factors which are important for preload assessment, afterload assessment, and the contractility of the heart with this, with the help of this system. And this is just a video, small video of a patient who was fluid responsive. He presented to us with severe metabolic acidosis, a lactate of 16, and this patient was given fluids and he got better. And on the same hand, you can see this patient who was a non-fluid, we did not do fluid resuscitation, and you can see the hemodynamics. This patient has high cardiac index, a very low SVR, is already having a high lung water score. So herein, you have to start these patients on vasopressors, and we should not be giving any additional fluid to these patients. So these patients will get harmed. So a lot of information on the hemodynamics can help us a targeted hemodynamic management, and this becomes very, very relevant when we deal with patients with cirrhosis and complex issues. This is another patient of ACLF who had a bilirubin of 25 and a lactate of around 6. And we can see here that this patient is very contracted. You will expect a SVR of 500, while the SVR is 1200 in this patient. His CVP is 2, his lung water is 6, even though the stroke volume variation is 5. So the stroke volume variation we are not getting in this patient. However, we can see here that this patient is definitely there may be a chance that we should try giving this patient some fluids to see that we can improve the hemodynamics and the lactates. So there's another system called the Lidko system, which is on based on the same concept. It is from Germany. So it also gives us the same assessment and based on the same technique of transpulmonary thermodilution, which will be discussed further in the next talk. Now, this is our data of the flow track, and we can understand that this, based on this, we tried to classify survivors and non-survivors in patients with cirrhosis, and we found that only the leak index, which was seen at enrollment and which persisted at 48 hours, as compared to all other indices, was associated with worse outcomes. So a high permeability index was associated with poor outcomes. And how do we detect hypervolemia? I have shown one technique, extravascular lung water. Apart from understanding the cardiac pump and assessing the static indices like IVC, the intra-abdominal pressure monitoring, and there's very limited data in patients with cirrhosis, but we do this routinely in our ICUs, and we see that in patients with cirrhosis who have tense ascites, there is a lot of organ perfusion, which is hampered, especially in patients with SBP, paralytic ileus, and therefore it becomes very, very important that we should be doing a good intra-abdominal pressure monitoring and seeing and looking for signs of hypervolemia versus hypovolemia in these patients. Now, coming to the last part of my talk, I'll just quickly touch upon which fluid which we should be, after we've assessed our patients for responsiveness, non-responsiveness of the fluid, it becomes important that whether we should be using crystalloids. Between the crystalloids, we have the option of saline and balanced crystalloid or the plasmolite, or we have the colloids. And within the colloid option, we have albumin and synthetic colloids. So let's look at what the guidelines tell us. The guidelines suggest that you should try and avoid crystalloids because this is associated with development of significant fluid retention and edema, especially in patients with liver disease who are sick, who are vasodilated and have sepsis. It is better to avoid crystalloids. And when we come to the discussion on synthetic colloids, it has been shown that hydroxy-HES, which was studied in different studies, has shown that it accumulates and it causes renal dysfunction. It's also very important that between the crystalloids, we look at the composition of the chloride, the composition of lactate, the composition of sodium, potassium, calcium, because there are other metabolic abnormalities that coexist in these patients. And we should be carefully choosing a good crystalloid composition or a good albumin preparation, because these also matter while we are managing and while we are giving fluids to patients with cirrhosis. Now, hydroxyethyl starch has been shown to worsen portal hypertension and hepatic dysfunction after repeated infusions, and therefore it is not recommended to use this colloid in the routine practice. We know about albumin data, and this was the largest trial of a large number of patients wherein 4% albumin was not shown to be superior to the saline group. However, when we come to patients with cirrhosis, because these patients are very, very different and they cannot be compared to other critically ill population, we did this trial in a very large cohort of 300 plus patients, which we called as the FRISC trial. And In this particular trial, we randomized these patients with liver disease to receive a bolus of sodium chloride, which was compared again 5% albumin. And we showed that the mean arterial pressure improvement, the clearances in the lactate was better with use of 5% albumin. Now, there are different albumin preparations again, but when you're using for resuscitation, just to make it simple, you should go for either 5% albumin or 4% albumin. However, when you're trying to use albumin in a hypervolemic patient or in a hyperoncotic state, it's better to go with 25% or 20% albumin. And this was a subsequent study which has now been accepted as an oral paper in EASL, wherein we compared patients with septic shock, plasmolite versus 20% albumin. And we found that, again, albumin was superior in improving the lactate clearances and improving the vasopressor dose. However, this was associated with more pulmonary complications. The immunomodulatory function of albumin also, this is our own data of lab laboratory in patients with sepsis, wherein we see that all the pro-inflammatory milieu, the monocyte functionality as assessed pre and post albumin infusion is shown to improve. And this also correlated with improvement in outcomes. And we can see here wherein the albumin was not able to improve the pro-inflammatory milieu, these patients also fared worse. Now, coming back to the patient where we discussed, this patient, we placed the hemodynamic monitor. The SVR was very poor. The cardiac output was good. The echo and the cardiac, there was no pump problem in this patient. The CVP was on the lower side. IVC was 10 and collapsible. And therefore, we resuscitated. And all the sepsis biomarkers were high. So we gave this patient's maintenance fluid at 50 ml after the initial resuscitation, started him on vasopressin as a second vasopressor because of the low SVR, and considered early colistin because we see a lot of multidrug resistant organisms in our ICU. And after 8 hours of therapy, we saw that vasopressin was tapered off, the fluid had worked, the sepsis management, norepinephrine decreased, and subsequently this patient's the pH after 24 hours had improved, the lactate clearances were monitored, the patient was switched to 25% albumin at day two, and he was extubated at day five. So to summarize, ladies and gentlemen, for fluid management, consider targets in liver patients of mean arterial pressure, lactate, urine output, do an individualized response guided, and use dynamic indices wherever possible. Hemodynamic monitoring and transpulmonary thermodilution is very, very helpful in difficult and complicated cases with multiple problems. The choice of fluid should be albumin, and we've shown some data of superiority of albumin even in context of sepsis with respect to crystalloids, or we can use a combination when the requirement is more. The crystalloid choice should also be guided by the composition, and balanced crystalloids are preferable wherever possible. And I thank you for your kind attention.